Okay, well, I live in Florida, so I took off 3 layers just to be able to move around up here. You know if this works. Okay. So I am doing the intergenerational and intercommunity transference of ethnobotanical knowledge, case study of Bubango. That's a lot. But when an elder dies, a library burns, Africa proverb, but we've all heard this in many iterations. And so we were looking into why don't we build a library? So the idea was to start with a booklet, and I did this research with Grace Donald. So, what were the goals of the project? Does this not do what this is doing? I guess not. Okay. So does creating a booklet help maintain ethnobotanical knowledge? And what role does language play in this process? What are the most effective ways to include people in the process? So I arrived in Tanzania and I wanted to connect with the people. So I bought a little bike like everybody has. I'm a lot taller than everybody. So I'm on this little bike and I'm going through the village on the first day and the little kids see me and they all come running out of the huts. And they're all coming and I'm thinking, here's the moment. And then I completely panicked. And I was on my little tiny bicycle and I tried to ride away from all the children. They're fast and they're chasing me and I'm not fast. I'm on a tiny bike. And I thought, oh my gosh, what am I doing? And that is exactly what I was doing. I just couldn't get away. And so I learned some Swahili as it went, and we all worked out it's okay to grab me, it's okay to grab a bike. Please don't unzip the backpack and take out the camera and the bananas. And we all worked it out. So who were these people? These people are the Ha. And in Tanzania, working right near Lake Tanganyika, in the community of Bubango. And it's right next to Gombe National Park, and I'll talk about that in a minute and why that's important. So there's a deforestation in this area from farming, from firewood collecting, construction. And this is particularly important because it is next to Gombe National Park. And Gombe National Park is where James Earl and our chimps are. So, right over this hill, that is where Bubango is. It borders Gombe National Park. And so this is a particularly important habitat. And we're walking through Gombe, and we're looking at where we are in relation to Bubango. And people said, oh, well, maybe you'll see James' chimps, maybe you won't. Okay, well, it's beautiful. I'm hiking out here. I don't need to see the chimps. And then we're walking for about 4 hours, and suddenly this big creature comes lumbering out, and oh my gosh, I cared a lot. I saw the chimps. It was incredible. And this chimp came and sat right there, and I was like, oh, and I got the chills all over. I was like, I can't believe I'm seeing this chimp. And then she turned, and she scratched her neck, and then she looked right at me. And I looked at her, and we're having this moment with this chimp, and I'm like, oh, this is it. And she gets up, and she starts to walk towards me, and I get my camera. And she throws a rock at my head. and the guy goes, you're not supposed to look at them. I'm sticking with plants. So, what was our methodology? We did informal and semi-structured interviews, informed consent with 21 people who were selected as ethnobotanical experts in medicine, crafts, music, construction, food, and ritual. We had each person come and discuss their top 5 plants, and then we had the entire group vote on which plants we wanted to flesh out for the actual booklet. So, to get to the study site, I'm on the back of a motorcycle. I'm cheering myself on. Clearly, I have a thing about getting on motorcycles in the field. I'm pretty excited about that. But what was interesting about this is the motorcycle drivers. So you're going along, and they've all got these little iPod things, so the music is and the wind is going, and it's in Kiswahili, which I barely understand, and we're talking. But once we get through all that, they're asking, you know, why are you on the back of my motorcycle? That is a good question. So I told them about the project. This is the project that we're doing, explaining. Keep that in mind for later. So we needed to see, we were excited about this, did the people in Bubango have an interest? Do they want to come and have a booklet of their useful plants? Yes, as one man said, the children are not learning about how to use plants. They only care about their cell phones. And, you know, it's not far off. So we are interviewing the elders, and this is a plant that's used as a musical instrument. But while we're doing this, there are other people who are interested. And if you look past the motorcycle helmets, then you start to see there were the peekers. And they were super, super curious. Why were we talking to the elders? What were we talking about? So they were watching and they were listening. What was important to us that we had to do this? So they're already starting to see some value in what we're pursuing. And so there was a lot of watching, and the adults and also the kids were watching. That's Grace collecting plants. That is someone whose first language is not English. Please tell your boobs to stop staring at my eyes. But I don't think that's why he's wearing it. But the point is, that is one of our motorcycle drivers. So we told him what we're doing. So he's asked, well, can I come and watch? So now he's listening about the useful plants in the community where he lives. And this is certainly not his initial interest before we started to bring this up. So we have a lot of people who are curious, people who are watching, but what we wanted was for people to be actively engaged, to be a part of this project. So we went to the schools directly. We want the kids, the next generation, these are the important ones, to start talking about ethnobotany. And we said, so who used plants today? Oh, everybody's hands went up and they were into it and they were excited. So enthusiasm is there. And we also wanted them to be a part of the final project, book itself. So we wanted to tap into what the kids like to do anyway. So we wanted to tap into drawing. And I had said, well, kids love drawing, they're going to just want to draw. And Grace said, well, if we make a contest and they're going to win prizes, then they're really going to want to draw. Okay, so here we are at the stationery store, and we are getting the school supplies as prizes. And just remember this man for later. He is the man who was selling us these supplies, and we're explaining to him what the project is. So this is Grace explaining the drawing portion of the contest, and to this man, who is the head of village education. Now, he's asking about the plants. He's in a room full of healers, and he's becoming interested in the ethnobotany of his own village. So we're getting the children involved, they're connecting to the plant, drawing it, they're looking and thinking, which plant do I want to draw, what does it look like, and language. They all had to do plant names in Kiha, which is the tribal language. So now we have the teachers who are judging the pictures. So now we have teachers who are getting involved in the ethnobotany. And this is Adam, one of the people who is working with us, and he's talking with this woman, and it's in Kisahili, so I barely understand, but I go, blah, 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 kiha, blah, 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 kiha, blah, 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 kiha, kiha. I was like, whoa. And it's, he was telling me they're doing a book in kiha, and we began to get that language. This was huge. This was a draw. People were connecting that their language was going to be written down in a book. So this is Rashidi, and we brought him to the town of Kigoma, out of the village, and we're translating Swahili, Kiha, and English. So that this is the booklet, and this is what an example of a page, and this was really the part. This is his written in Kiha. We made sure that we had Kiha be first, and then Swahili, and lastly, English. So this is the list of plants. We also have all the additional plants that were not included, that fleshed out in the book of the piece. There's Grace is still working with identifications. And in future analysis, we did take for all of the half of the plant part pages, the collection, the preparation, accessibility, the location, so that would be a different set of data. And this was a part where we wanted to make sure that this book was of value. We wanted to give credibility to it. So we organized a big ceremony with the villagers as a way to present the book, to show that this was important information. So we have the dancers, and if you see that what he's got on his feet is that plant we saw in the beginning. So they do the whole wow. And there's all this going on, and we've got people watching, and it's great. And then we want the noise, we want the hoopla, we want the people to come and see what's happening. Now this particular group on this side, the others have come on purpose. These people actually had captive audience because they were working on land titles with the chief had also told us to come, so he left them and came to us, so they also walked the ceremony. But whatever brought people there, people were paying attention. People were absorbed in what they were watching. So we were giving the books to the ethnobotanical specialists, and you see that they're continuing. We're talking about it. The discussion goes, it's alive, it's relevant. And you get to see their faces when they see their words in the Kiha in a book. And then you have people who are not experts, who are becoming experts right there. So, but you're getting this excitement that is spreading through the community. And we gave copies to the school children, who were also very interested. And it went beyond the community. This is where we went to a Western training doctor and giving him the book. People at the Jane Goodall Institute. People at the processed food store. This man is very influential in town. Either influential people or giving it to the priests. We're back at the stationery store. And he said, I heard it was in Kiha. So he wanted one. And then from the back of the store, we heard, I want a book in Kiha. So he gave one to the guy from the back of the store. And then other villages asked us, we heard you made a book in Kiha. Can you come make a book in our language about our plants? And then it went beyond these villages, the place where I was staying, this was Cosmos. I told everybody I'm making a book, I gave him a book, and he said, I don't want to make a book. So he's collecting plants, and he's writing down the information about the use, but for him, he wants to write the uses that the animals are using. So if people are valuing their plants, they're valuing their forest. And this is a picture of forest that for 10 years has been protected. So this is Roseback, it's Miombo Woodlands, it grows back, and there's hope we can get people to connect to the forest that way. To reconnect, they're connected. So in conclusions, what role does language play? I'm starting with the second question. Kiha was huge. The most effective ways of really the group meetings, keeping everyone involved, having it be their project, interviews, collecting, and doing all this in public. The kids started to watch. Really, the drawing and the ceremonial presentation was key. So the big question, does it help maintain ethnobotanical knowledge? Well, they have a record, okay, so that information is not lost. We tried to make it look aesthetically pleasing with colors and photos so people would be drawn to it. It would be some stuffy book, it would be something fun to see. And then we were surprised by the spatial dimensions. We were doing this just for Bubango, and then it went to other villages, into the town of Kigoma, motorcycle drivers, and then evolving into an animal plant book for someone else. So we also really got that the process, making the process as public as possible, that was just as important as the actual book. So is it effective in the present? Yes. It's got people excited. In the future, that will require further study. So this is for future generations to have access to their own knowledge. And just this was after the ceremony had rained, and there was some mud dancing. So just particularly to thank the community of Bubango and also National Geographic. Thank you.